and tell us about your cultural background and the languages that play a role in your life. We'll go in the order of the slides. So Colin Wioto, can you please tell us about yourself, the cultural background and the languages in your life?
Ooh, I'm first.
Okay. Buongiorno. Bonjour. Selamat pagi. Ni hao. What else? What else am I missing? Guten Morgen. Ohayou gozaimasu. Alrighty. Hi everyone, my name is Colin.
Oh, that's me.
I'm originally from Indonesia, from a small city called Malang in East Java. Any Indonesians here? Hi. Anyone studying Indonesian? Bagus, bagus. Okay, so I moved to Perth in 2010. I went to Mount Lawley Senior High, and I didn't pick up any foreign languages at the time because I was trying to improve my English, but I continued Indonesian as a background speaker, and I'll talk more about it later. I'm doing my last semester of my Bachelor of Arts here at UWA. Exciting, I'm gonna graduate soon. And I study a Bachelor of Arts in French and Linguistics. I actually do linguistics with Sinlan. And that's my picture in Lyon, in France, with the Indonesian community. So yes, I have been traveling all around the world. Why? Because I study languages.
Shaima.
Hi everyone, my name is Shaima. I'm currently studying engineering and Italian here at UWA. I'm in my last year of studies and hopefully I'll be continuing on to masters next year onwards, and I'll be doing masters in civil engineering. I'm Turkish, so I speak Turkish at home and I grew up learning Turkish. And I started studying Italian at high school. Prior to that, I was learning Indonesian in primary school, but I don't remember much of it. It didn't particularly appeal to me. So when I started high school, we were given the option between Japanese and Italian, and I thought I'd give European languages a go. So I studied Italian until year 10, compulsory, and then decided to continue it on, and I'll talk more about that. And when I got to university, decided to continue it on with my engineering studies as well. And I think that's all for me.
Thank you, Shaima. Ross.
What's up? So, yeah, I'm a diehard Aussie, born and bred here. But, you know, I thought I'd give language learning a go at school, and I was lucky enough to have the opportunity to learn Indonesian. Funnily enough, I've met Colin before. He's a great guy, and he really knows his languages. I'm a bit of a young gun here, actually. I'm only in my second year, but I'm assured entry medicine, so I'm studying medical sciences with the second major in Indonesian. You really can combine these language studies with a lot of different things, as you're probably going to see. I was lucky enough to have the opportunity to travel to Indonesia and do some intensive language courses, and it was an amazing experience. I'll say a bit more about that later too. And yeah, that's about it. I grew up in the country and had to travel a long way to go to school, so really enjoying the opportunities that are available to me here at UWA.
Thank you, Ross.
Sinlan. Hi, everyone. My name is Sinlan. My first language is Cantonese, and I came to Australia about 2002. And right now, I'm a Japanese and linguistics major in my final year at UWA. To give you a small taste of what a Japanese major's life is like here, let me divert your eyes to this screen for a bit. So on the left there was me on the Genesis program in 2016, although it's 15 there, but that's what the hell they name it, I don't know why. I was with my host family overlooking the city of Nagasaki on a Ferris wheel, and at the bottom was just us skipping across a river on a weekend morning. And on the right was me on the new Colombo Planet Zoo Immersion program in 2016. At the top, we're all dressed in business garb, looking pretty smart and learning about corporate culture. And at the bottom, which is us, looking at the first cherry blossoms in the country during our free time. And next slide, please. And other programs I've been involved in was the National Japanese Language Speech Contest, where I got first prize and managed to win like a return trip in Japan. So that was me just trekking up a snowy mountain. It was called Mount Togakushi in Nagano Prefecture. And it was great. And just to give you a brief idea about what I'll be doing after graduation. So immediately after graduation, I will become a coordinator for international relations on the JET program in Kyushu in Oita Prefecture, where I'll be working with the local government. So yeah, it's exciting stuff. I encourage you to learn a foreign language here because it always brings you exciting people and opportunities. Hope our talk today will make you more enthusiastic. So, thank you.
Thank you, Sidna.
Hello everyone, my name is Holden Shepherd. I work as a young adult author and copywriter, but before that I studied the Bachelor of Arts. So I studied writing and French. I've come from Geraldton as well, so I'm a Gerardero, so I'm not the only country person on the panel. So I've studied a little bit of Japanese in high school, which I'll talk about shortly, but I didn't have the opportunity to continue with that. The only thing I can remember is, I'm going to say this wrong, Tsukini Kawatte Oi Shoukyo, which is from Sailor Moon, which means in the name of the moon, I'll punish you. That's the only thing I can remember from my Japanese studies, unfortunately. Beyond that, I've studied Italian, half Sicilian, so I speak Italian on the Sicilian dialect, and my main study has been in French. So I'll talk about majoring in French and going beyond the major and doing some extra studies to get fluent. Some of these photos are from a few of my travels. So the one at the bottom is the Eiffel Tower by night. I took my partner on a dinner cruise down the Seine and proposed that night. The other one down here is in Mauritius, where they speak English, French, and Creole. So they don't speak any Creole, but it's a really fun language if you want to swear at people, apparently. So I practice my French there. Top right is in, it's right on the shore of Lake Como in Italy, which is absolutely beautiful. And the top left is when I used to host a radio show on community radio called French Conic, and it was all in French. So we'd showcase French music and speak in French and talk about French culture. So it's really fun. That's me.
Great, thank you very much. Okay, so we'll get underway with the panel discussion. So what we're going to do is I will ask some questions to each of the panel members, and then we'll hear from them, you know, regarding their experiences. So Shaima, can you please tell us why you chose to continue with Italian beyond year 10 and then into university?
Yeah, so like I said, I started high school and started studying Italian, and I'm glad my teachers aren't here because I didn't particularly enjoy it. It was just a subject that I was doing. I didn't, you know, there were a lot of distractions in class. It was a big class. It didn't really appeal to me, but when I got to year 10, I thought I'd continue on to year 11 and 12, purely based on academics and the LOAT bonus that we've spoken about. So it was just a strategic decision. And I think that was probably one of the best decisions I've made in my life. And I think I can make that call looking back at it now. Year 11 and 12, I was exposed to a lot more of the Italian culture. And being Turkish myself, I felt that there were a lot of factors that I could relate to and a lot of things that I could say, hey, we have that too. It's just a bit tweaked. It's just a bit different with us. Fare della figura, a lot of different aspects of Italian that I could literally say, yeah, I relate to that. I get that. And I found that I was living a lot of my Turkish culture through my Italian learning. And so, got through year 11 and 12, finished year 12, and by that point I thought, I can't just leave Italian, it can't just be 5 years of my life, but I just did it, and it's done, over it with. So I was quite unsure what I wanted to do when I got to uni, and I thought, I'll explore my options, I'll see what I can do with engineering, and I'll definitely incorporate Italian into my degree as well. And here, the course structure at UW actually allows you to do multiple majors. So I've got some friends doing engineering and finance, engineering and psychology, different majors that you can incorporate. So I decided to stick with engineering and Italian, and I think I can make the call that that was probably the second best decision I've made in my life. Over the 3 years that I've been learning Italian, I've been exposed a lot more. I thought I had it, like a little peek of it in year 11 and 12, but I started learning a lot more in uni. And yeah, I'd say that's been my experience so far. I really enjoyed it. It's been, like I said, the best decision I've made, and yeah.
Great, thank you, Shayma. Colin, you're an incredibly passionate language learner. Tell us what you love about each of the languages you speak and the highlights of learning languages.
All right, first of all, if I ramble on, Eros, just stop me. And you're like, next! So, don't freak out. I actually do speak seven languages with different degrees of fluency. So, I have two mother tongues, which is Indonesian and Javanese. Let me repeat. Javanese, not Japanese. So it's the language of the island of Java. And then obviously I learned English and then I came here. I speak a bit of Mandarin. I understand better than I can speak or write because, hello. I'm Indo-Chinese, so my ancestors are from, originally from Fujian in China. Is anyone from Fujian? No? Anyone from China? Yeah. Okay. And then at uni, I decided to learn French, and then next year Spanish, and then next year Italian. Let me start by Indonesian. I have a neutral feeling for Indonesian because it's the national language of the country, but I love to write in Indonesian. Back when I was in Indo, I used to be so involved in journalism and creative writing, and I got two short stories published in the magazine, and I did get paid for that. Japanese, my other mother tongue. I describe it as an earthy language because it's the language that, I don't know, home. It's that, you know, it brings me back home. And it gives me that extra layer of defining my identity, not only that I'm Chinese background, Indonesian by birth, but I'm also Javanese because I was born in that area. And I love to swear in Javanese. Anyone from Java here? Yes, okay. So, you know the F word in English, right? I'm not gonna say it. But in Javanese, right, there is this word that starts with J. Do you guys know which one I'm talking about? Yeah, I love saying that word. When I'm angry, yeah? And then, don't say it. And English is very useful, you know. I use it for academic and for work. English actually helped me to learn French, and then Spanish, and then Italian, because of a lot of like vocabulary similarities between English and French. And French, I love French literature, music, philosophy. And when I speak French, I feel. Huh? Oui, madame. I feel more sophisticated, more, I don't know, more intelligent. Can I say snob?
No, like philosopher.
Okay, philosopher, okay. Español. Does anyone speak Spanish here? Yeah? ¿De dónde eres? De México. Ooh. When I speak Spanish, I feel sexy. Like... Shakira. Cuando hablo en español, me siento muy sexy. Quiero bailar, ¿no? And it's very useful. It's spoken in more than 20 countries. You can travel around, you know, South America and just speak Spanish. Quickly, Italian, happy, romantic, has allowed me to travel around Italy, appreciate art, history, and food. And I did get the chance to visit my professor's hometown in Bergamo. Mandarin, it's important for me to go back to my roots, and it's the language of my ancestors and my grandparents. So, yeah, love it.
Right, thank you, Colin. Sinan, you have been learning Japanese since you were in high Why did you continue to study it beyond your team and then at university?
Okay, let me just start for a bit. As we were saying, after you pick up a second language, everything gets a lot easier. People go, English is like the language of science. It's like really organized. I'm just like, But once I got through that, it was okay. I started in U10 and continued Japanese for one simple reason, because it was fun. And the other thing is, I really enjoy going to the hot springs. I went to swimming, I almost cooked myself. And then, let's see, I think a lot of people from our generation got into Japanese because of pop cultural elements like anime and music. For myself, it was detective and sci-fi novels, no judgment. And as I became an adult, I thought, I have to earn my own bread now. Might as well do something that I enjoy. So yeah, I continued through in uni. What I'm trying to say is, like, there's nothing wrong about choosing a language because you like the lighter aspects of its culture. So yeah, why not give it a shot?
Great, thank you, Sinta. Holden, you studied Japanese in years 8 and 9 at high school, but didn't have the opportunity to continue into the senior secondary years. How did you feel about this lack of opportunity, and why did you decide to recommence studying your language at university?
Thank you. So as I mentioned before, I studied a little bit of Japanese in year 8 and 9 high school. So I went to high school in Geraldton, and basically the opportunity is not the same as in a larger metropolitan city. If the teacher who teaches Japanese moves away, the Japanese course goes away. So that's what happened. So I was enrolled to study Japanese in year 10 and kind of rocked up on the first day of Japanese class, and they said, there's no teacher. The teacher moved away, so we didn't have the option, and that was the end of my Japanese studies. So I guess just a caveat to say, value what you guys have, because you have a lot of opportunities here to study languages. I was a bit bitter about that. So I really wanted to study a language, and I'd always been keen to learn other languages. So when I got to the end of year 12, and I basically turned 18 the next week, I went on a gap year, just backpacked around Europe for a bit. And I realized I really loved language. I loved French, I loved Italian, I loved the Romance languages. And I really wanted to learn how to speak like these people. Like, if you've heard people speak fluently in Italian and French, they just sound amazing. They just sound so impressive, and that's that kind of that philosophical snobby kind of thing, but they sound really cool. And I thought, I want to sound cool like that. So that's what I chose to do. So rather than pick up Japanese, I picked up Italian and French. One thing I would consider, if you're going to study more than one language at once, which is what I did, consider whether or not you have the capacity in your brain to do that. So I was studying Italian and French at the same time, and I got into one of my oral exams and was asked something really basic, and it was the French oral exam, and I went, "Si." It is a word in French, but it wasn't the right word I was trying to say. I was trying to say "oui." So consider whether or not you can take on both of those at the same time. So basically I chose to drop Italian after a while to focus on the French, and I wanted to get really, really good at French. So I did a major in French introductory. I have no background at all in French, so starting from scratch. I don't know enough about UWA whether you can start from scratch. You can, yep. I studied at ECU, so I was able to start as an introductory student, went through intermediate level, and then through the advanced units. After I did that, I thought I want more. So after I finished my course, I actually went back just to do a diploma by itself. So a diploma of language studies in French. And after I did that, I was like, I still wanted more because I wasn't still fluent, and I really wanted to sound cool, and I still sounded really stuttery. So I did something through Alliance Française called the DELF, which is the Diplôme Approfondi de Langue Française. And that is further study. It's like an examination, basically, from the French Ministry of Education. And once you pass that, it gives you entrance into like French university, or you can work freely in France. And it accredits you as a level of fluency in French, basically. So that's kind of my journey in terms of what I've studied after that.
Thanks for holding me. Ross, you are a medical student who has also continued with your language studies. Why did you decide to continue with Indonesian at high school and beyond?
Yeah, so it's a good question, and I think Holden hit the nail on the head about a couple of things there. First of all, the opportunity. I just jumped on every opportunity that's presented itself before me. I love challenges, that's another reason why I took it. And since Indonesian was the only language that was taught at my school, and I wanted to learn a language, I just went for it. Better yet, at my school they offered an accelerated program. So you could do your year 11 in year 10 and your year 12 in year 11, so a year earlier. And I really liked that. It meant that I could focus really hard on studying Indonesian when I had a reduced study load in my other year 12 subjects. And it meant that I could do a lot better in it, I think, retrospectively. I forgot to mention before, I'm just about to finish Spanish level 1. And I picked up a little bit of Javanese because one of the cleaners at the place where I studied in Indonesia loved to teach me some in the mornings. Great guy. So,
do you know the J word?
Let's just not say that. yeah, didn't get much beyond actually saying good morning and good evening, but yeah, very earthy language. So, in terms of studying at university, so I had a year's break in year 12 from Indonesian because I was just doing my other subjects. They let you come in at that high level, so I began at level 3 and 4 Indonesian at university, so I could continue sort of where I left off. And as a study technique, I can recommend to all of you, in particular if you're not going to be actively studying, keep a diary. As soon as you can talk about your daily routines, the simplest of things, you know, you might think it's going to be a bit repetitive, but it's a really good way to turn over all of that vocabulary. So furthermore, like was said before by one of our professors, most people are bilingual, and now living at college, on College Road, St. Catharines, most of the people that I live with are bilingual, trilingual, can speak more languages, and it just opens so many doors. You know, when you can talk to someone in their own language, all of a sudden you're speaking to their heart. The saying goes, you know, you can talk to them in a language they understand, it goes to their head, but you speak to them in their own language, it goes to their heart. And I've found that to be very true in all my experiences. Beyond that, I've always wanted to travel but not have many opportunities. Whenever my family had a vacation, it'd be camping in the bush. anyone here from Gingin? No, I didn't think so. So, yeah, it really gave me... What was that? Was that someone?
Someone...
Yeah, I understand if you don't want to claim being from Gingin. Yeah, not much to it. So, yeah, it was an opportunity to travel also that was open for me, because otherwise I really wouldn't have had, I guess, an incentive to do so, because I felt like I needed to focus on my studies and always be working. So, yeah, that's it.
Thank you. When you went to high school in Australia, what benefits did it bring?
Okay. As I said before, in high school, I didn't pick up any foreign languages like French, Italian, or Chinese, because at the time I wanted to improve my English, so I did the ESL program. But I also continued with my Indonesian, I think it's called Indonesian background speakers. Simply because I love Indonesian, right? Aku cinta bahasa Indonesia. You too, kamu juga?
Sama-sama.
So I wanted to continue speaking and learning about my own language here in Perth. So that's reason number one. Reason number two, load bonus, come on. That load ATAR bonus, you know, that extra score. I wanted that, you know. If that could get my ATAR from, I don't know, say 90 to 93 or 90 to 95, bring it on. Right? And that's not just for Indonesian, for whatever languages you guys are studying. And don't forget, I think the presentation that was given before, you guys can actually learn other languages, like your own languages, if it's available, and you just need to contact the right person. And don't you just love it when people acknowledge your skills and efforts? And give you that extra bonus, right? So that's the reason why I decided to learn Indonesian in high school.
Thank you, Colin. Ross, tell us about your experience of combining languages with your medical studies. studies at UWA. How do you think you'll be able to use your language skills in your work as a doctor?
Right, so combining the studies actually is pretty straightforward. As has sort of been explained already, you can take two majors. Actually, I have a pretty hectic mate that's doing three by adding on overloading units and doing some units. So you just choose them at the start. And with my degree-specific major being in medical sciences, my second major is in Indonesian, because I'm only undergrad at the moment. Postgraduate medicine, that's a whole other story. So it's pretty straightforward. You just choose your units and you have your equivalency and you just get going and turn up to classes. In terms of my future aspirations, so as someone who's become aware of the global situation and had a chance to travel and see the difference in the health systems between some developed nations and developing nations, I think there's a great potential for people to take on some leadership, in particular privileged people like ourselves, in what really is the lucky country here, and make a difference somewhere else. So, you know, a lot of people, you know, like the idea of doing some humanitarian work, volunteering, you know, build a school or just hand out aid, etc. But I thought, what can I do that is going to be more powerful than that? How can I upskill so that when I go in to make a difference, it's really going to stick? And so I thought, if I can learn the language of a nation that's developing, that has a health system that's still very much developing, as is the case in Indonesia, and with such a disparate group of islands, really, it's incredible. The archipelago has, is it 17,000 or something? There's a lot.
Heaps.
Yeah. The logistics of building a health system, it's almost impossible. It's crazy. So in the future, I'd like to work in Indonesia, in particular in the developing health system, in facing those diseases and conditions that really have simple solutions. Things that, you know, you can vaccinate, that you can treat with antibiotics, that you can really get a handle on. As compared to some of the first world problems, like obesity, etc., I won't go into a med rant, but a lot of them seem pretty intractable to me in particular, thinking rationally. I'm not really sure how to deal with those things. Yeah, a bit scared about being a GP, to be honest. So that's part of my vision, really. I'd like to go in and make a difference.
Thank you, Ross. Thanks very much for that. Okay, so we're mindful that this forum is the length of two Norman University lectures, so congratulations, you've made it. So if you're feeling good and hanging in there, that's awesome, you're ready for university. If you are not sitting, not used to sitting for such long periods of time, you can have a stretch, so just stand up for about 10 seconds, have a little bit of a chat, high school. Tell us how you managed to fully develop Turkish. Do you have any messages for people in the community who speak another language at home, other children or parents?
Yeah, unfortunately, I wasn't aware of the opportunity of studying Turkish in high school, and I found out very late. I was about halfway through year 12 when I found out that you could actually study other languages that weren't offered at your school. So if you are interested, definitely do your research, because like we've been saying this whole time, the 10% low bonus really makes a difference. So in terms of maintaining my language, it's been pretty important for my parents for us to maintain Turkish and to be able to speak Turkish in, like, for my siblings and myself. Just to give you a bit of context, got two older siblings, an older sister and a brother, and I'm the youngest of the three. And my parents moved here when my siblings were quite young, but I was actually born here. So we were fully immersed into the Turkish culture in all aspects in our home. We had Turkish TV, Turkish news, Turkish radio, Turkish music. Yeah, Turkish delight, lots of Turkish delight. Yes, we eat kebabs every night. All the stereotypes. We were fully immersed into the language and the culture. And it was really, really important for my parents So we had a strictly Turkish-only policy at home, and we were only allowed to, well, I'm not going to say we were forced to speak Turkish, but we were very strongly encouraged to speak Turkish amongst my siblings and my parents as well. That sort of changed when we sort of established the language and my parents knew that, okay, like, you can speak Turkish. It just got to a point where it got easier to speak English with my siblings. So, late teens, we were allowed to speak English with our siblings, but even now, my parents still expect a Turkish response. So if they ask me a question and I respond in English, they'll act like they don't understand. They demand a Turkish response. And another aspect is also travels. I think that's really, really important. We remained really close with our families back in Turkey. So because it was just the five of us here, when we went back home and we had like a huge family, I was like, wow, this is so different. So I got really close with my cousins and aunts and uncles. And when we came back to Australia, it was like, oh, well, I miss them now and I need to keep in touch with them. So I still message my cousins. I'm still really close to them. And obviously, because they can't speak English, I need to be able to speak Turkish to communicate with them. So that's also a really important aspect, I find, to have close community ties, close ties with your family, whether it be with your grandparents or, you know, someone back home that you, that sort of prompts you and pushes you to speak your language. I think it's really important if you do have a community language that you do keep it at home, because I think language is a really important part of cultural identity, and that's really shaped me to become who I am now. And even though I was born in Australia and I was raised here and I grew up here, have Australian friends, I still identify myself as Turkish because that was the language that I grew up with at home. And I think that's really important that we do hold on to those ties. And of course, we live in Australia, we have an Australian lifestyle 100%, but make sure you do hold on to your community language because it really is important.
That's important. That's a very, very valuable point, you know, that you've brought up, Shayma. And I think with Facebook, Instagram, and all the technology that we've got available, WhatsApp, we share multiple identities, so you might communicate with cousins or relatives overseas. And, you know, you feel part of that too. So going forward, a language as well, to uncover those key human relationships is a very, very big thing. Holden, can you tell us about how you found your knowledge of French to be useful both here in Perth and while travelling overseas? Also, what other skills have you developed through your language studies?
Before I pass it on to Holden, I actually like to hear a bit of Turkish from Shayma. Is that okay?
We might, if you'd like to, Shayma.
What do you want?
Just a sentence.
Just a sentence.
Günaydın, merhaba, benim adım Shayma. So that was good morning. Hello, my name is Shayma. Burada üniversitede mühendislik okuyorum. I'm doing engineering here at E.
Wow. Thank you, Shayma. Tell it to Holden. Tell us about how you have found your knowledge of French to be useful both here in Perth and while travelling overseas. Also, what other skills have you developed through your language studies?
Okay, great. So I guess the first and most obvious skill you pick up when you study language is the ability to use it, which means you can use it in its own context. So when I've travelled back to France, Belgium, Switzerland, Italy, Mauritius, I've been able to use these languages that I've studied. And it is a really cool feeling, I think. Those on have done the same thing. It's a really cool feeling of mastery when you can go to a country and speak in the local language and actually get along and kind of make your own way and make yourself understood and get things that you need. You can also, as a traveller, it makes you a little bit more of a savvy traveller. Like I had to deal with some taxi drivers in Sicily who were trying to rip me off. So thankfully I could speak Italian and Sicilian, so I can swear at them a little bit in the right language. But I could also kind of engage with them in Italian and say, actually, I'm not paying you, and this is what's happened, this is what I was expecting. So it actually gives you a little bit more competency when you're a traveller in those countries. In terms of personal experience and benefits, my partner's a native French speaker, so that helps. But more broadly than that, it helps with my in-laws. So it's really useful to be able to speak to my in-laws and impress them in their native tongue. And more broadly than that, I think we'd all agree that kind of learning another language kind of helps your love life. Like generally, like it makes you more more attractive in some way, I guess you'd say. People are always really impressed when you say you can speak a language. So I don't think I'm wrong exactly.
No, I'm not wrong.
beyond the personal stuff, in my work, kind of in my domain of working and writing and that kind of thing, being able to speak and read French is really useful for research. So I was doing a paper for my honours thesis a while back, and I had to find a particular piece of information, and it just didn't exist in English. Like there was no research in English on this particular thing, and I had to search and search, and I found it in French. There's this whole French journal article that talked about exactly what I needed, and thankfully I spoke the language and I could use it for my thesis. Kind of what we were saying before about the web pages across the world being in different languages, same with research and knowledge in general. Knowledge is in a whole heap of other languages, it's not always translated across. So that's been really beneficial. It's really good as a party trick when I do press and media kind of stuff as an author. I'm sorry, by the way, I speak French. And that kind of gives the interviewer something to ask me and talk about. And I guess in a really corporate sense, which is a little bit boring maybe, but I work in stakeholder management and relationship management for a university, so I have to build rapport with people. And you would never believe how far it can go to know someone's native language and be able to communicate to them in that. So even last week, I was thinking, how am I going to, you know, what am I going to talk about when I talk about how I use my French experience? And that exact night, I was running an event, someone rocked up to it late, she was panicking. She said, hello, my name is Laurence. I said, oh, welcome, Laurence. She's like, they pronounced that perfectly. And we ended up having this 10-minute chat in French, and then we became best buds. And that just built this total rapport between us. And I realized I do that all the time with students, with colleagues, with external stakeholders. You use that language to build rapport. And even when I used to work in banking, which was really not fun, but there used to be a lot of Italian customers who'd come in, and they wouldn't know how to speak English. And you become the guy who spoke to the Italian customers to help them get their money out or to send money back home to Italy and things like that. So in terms of like making yourselves more employable and having a career and becoming more internationalised and how you think about getting a job and where you're going to go with your life, because you probably won't just stay in Perth. You may work overseas, you may live overseas. This stuff helps you become a more internationalised citizen of the world, so to speak.
Thank you, Holden.
Opportunities to spend time in Japan through university years. Can you give a brief overview of the programs you were involved in and the skills you have gained from this time in Japan?
So all the events and programs that I spoke about, I knew them via UWA. The first one was the Genesis program, which is sponsored by the Japanese government. It focuses on the mutual cultural understanding exchange between youth of Asia, the Asia Pacific and Japan. So the whole process basically goes down like this. You go through a selection process, get sent to Tokyo, and then you group with other university students all around Australia. You spend some time in Tokyo and then spend the rest of your time there in our host, selected host city. In our way, our group was fortunate enough to go to Nagasaki, a place with a pretty unique history. First of all, because it was one of the very few places that was open to foreigners during the 16th to 18th century, when Japan adopted a pretty isolationist foreign policy. And secondly, if you recall, it's one of the two cities ever to be hit by the atomic bomb. So during our time there, we learned quite a bit about the complex relationship between Japan and the West in its early days. And furthermore, we spoke with the local students from the Nagasaki University and heard about the stance on the future of nuclear usage. And the other program was the New Colombo Mitsui Immersion Program, that's quite a mouthful. It was sponsored by the Australian government and Mitsui & Co., which is a multinational journal trading company based in Japan, in Perth as well. This one also focuses on cultural exchange, but more on the corporate side of things. So basically, we spent a lot of time going to different Japanese corporates. One of them was the Toyota automobile factory production line. It sounds like, what? But believe me, it's really cool. We weren't allowed to take any photos because Japanese people are pretty secretive about these kind of things, but it's really cool. You should go to this program if you can. The rest of the time we spent in Tokyo and did a lot of workshopping about the business models, and we had some opportunities to come up with our own business models as well. So yeah, during all those two programs, I learned a lot about Japanese corporate culture and had the opportunity to communicate with like local students as well as like other Australian students. So there was a pretty healthy balance between like soft and hard skills. Yeah, I definitely recommend it.
Thank you, Sinplan. Short of time, so we just might keep the answers brief. I know there's a lot that we want to say, but if we just keep them succinct. So Ross, you participated in the in-country study program with the Australian Consortium for In-Country Indonesian Studies based here at UWA. Can you please explain what it is, the opportunities it provides for students to learn Indonesian, and how the experience has benefited you?
All right, so Ashichas is a non-profit organisation that's affiliated with universities around Australia. So it's separate from them, but linked. It's actually based here in UWA, that's where their main office is. But it doesn't matter which university you go to, you can do one of their programs. What they run are in-country studies in Indonesia. So it doesn't have to be Indonesian language, actually. That's only one of more than 30 different courses that they provide. You can do law, you can do business, you can do commerce, you can even do public health, which is something I'm planning to do in the future. What's better yet is that the government will pay you to go. So you can actually make money from doing an exchange. I kid you not. There's $3,000 New Colombo Plan grants to go on short courses, and there's $5,000 to $7,000 New Colombo Plan grants to go for semester exchanges. And literally, you just need to be an Australian citizen and be enrolled in order to get one of those. It's that simple. Beyond that, there are New Colombo Plan scholarships that are quite prestigious, and there's a whole selection process for them, and they're a big deal. But the opportunity is definitely there. What I did was two back-to-back Indonesian language short courses in Salatiga, which is in central Java, hence why I picked up a bit of Javanese. And that was an awesome experience. In terms of what it has directly benefited me with, I got 12 credit points towards my degree, so I'm actually ahead on my units, and next year we'll have a reduced study load as a result. And it was just an amazing experience, unforgettable in so many ways that I kind of explained succinctly. But at the core of it, I've now got a family in Indonesia, and that's literally what my homestay family, because I did a homestay, said to me when they left, "Kamu ada keluarga di Indonesia juga." You also have family in Indonesia now. So, you know, I'll never forget that. And I'll always be willing and ready to travel to Indonesia and see them all again. And I made so many friends too. So yeah, definitely worth it.
Great. Shane, what do students expect if they're studying a language like Italian at UWA?
A lot of cultural immersion, and I don't take that lightly, because I don't think it's possible to learn a language without learning about the culture. And in high school, there's only so much exposure that you can get to a culture. I've had units here where we've studied Italian food, Italian geography, about Italian history, and how that's shaped Italy to become the contemporary Italy that it is now. Expect amazing lecturers, because we really are blessed with amazing lecturers, and could not praise them enough. Marinella, Kinda, John Kinda, Vincenzo, and amazing teachers. Just to show you, just to give you a brief example of it, they're really supportive and they really challenge you. I think this book, we started reading this book in my first year of uni, it must have been second semester, and you can see how thick that is. And John told us, we're going to read this in class, and every week we're going to have a presentation on it. So every week a different person will be presenting a different chapter. So that was the book. And we told him, John, there's no way that's going to happen, mate. Like, that's not possible. We're not going to be able to read it. We're not going to be able to understand it. He challenged us, and he told us to stick to it, to get through it. By the end of my third year, I was reading this book in class, double the complexity. It's double the thickness as well, but there's a lot more context that's required for it, you need to have a lot more understanding. Like I said, the vocab's a lot more complex. And thank you, John, he's not here anymore. Is he? Woo! Thank you! Because if it wasn't for you telling us to read this, we wouldn't have gotten this far. By the end of our third year, we were reading Italian operas where we literally had to sit in class and decipher what was going on because it wasn't even contemporary Italian. So expect a lot of cultural immersion. You will get, we had units where we were studying Italian migration, Italian linguistics, language attrition, what I was talking about with my Turkish and how that, like how you lose a language being in a different country. Italians in Australia, how have they changed our lives? How have they impacted Australian society? So it's really not what you see in high school. Give it a go. But I think this will be the overall motive from the whole panel tonight, today, will be just give it a go because you don't know how it's going to change your life. And yet, Shema would have had no idea how Italian shaped her life because it really has changed me and shaped me into the person that I am now.
What can students expect from studying languages at ECU? What were the highlights?
The most important thing that I was told when I first started studying a language was from a guy called Dr. Damon Elder, who taught French at ECU. And he said, the first function of memory is to forget. And that's kind of underpins the whole philosophy of our language teaching at ECU. So rather than focusing on learning the content all the time, we focus on actually within the classroom using the language over and over and over. So we learn to converse primarily in the language and we learn to listen primarily in that language the whole time we're in the room. The course at ECU takes a seminar structure, so we don't just have a lecture and tutorial. These words might mean nothing to you guys now, but once you're hearing me, they will. It's usually a 3-hour seminar with a break in the middle, so you kind of learn some content and actually learn to speak along the same time. The really valuable thing is not the classroom stuff. No matter where you go, so if you go to ECU, you go to UWA, you go to Curtin, wherever the language is taught, the valuable stuff is what you do at home. And when I say at home, it's not usually reading a book alone in solitary confinement. It's usually speaking to the other people you study with and actually practicing. So we would all go for coffees together and speak only in French. And it was really crap. We couldn't really express ourselves very well. But that's what you have to do to get good at a language. You actually need to use it constantly. So that kind of facilitated that, and I think a little bit of the cultural immersion stuff as well. So we would go and go to the French Film Festival, we'd go to our lecturer's house and she'd cook us a meal, you know, traditional French dishes. We would do stuff like going and playing petanque and just speaking French while we did that. So learning the language, learning the culture kind of does go hand in hand, as you would say. And I think you learn a lot, like the way ECU's course is structured as well. It's studied through the lens of different topics, possibly similar to what you guys have as well. So you might do a unit that's just focused on history, you might do a unit that's focused on politics, you might do a unit that's focused on media or science, but you're learning the language through those topics and through those themes. So it's really an immersive process, it's really an incredible journey. The one thing I just want to add, I guess, before I finish my part is that no matter what you study in terms of your other major, so whether you do arts or law or engineering or medicine or whatever, do something that you like. And add the language on, because don't worry too much about the employability stuff. Like, if you're a good operator and you're motivated, you'll make yourself employable no matter what you do. So do something you really enjoy, do a language that you really enjoy, and you will go far. And please do study a language, because we need way more people in Australia studying languages, so we are more internationally focused.
Yeah.
Thank you. That's all.
Such a broad range of language skills, what type of career path are you hoping to follow in the future, and how do you foresee your knowledge of languages being beneficial? We might just keep the answers brief because we want to get the questions.
Okay, so just me personally, I'm interested in education, theatre and languages. I'm going to do honours next semester, so that's research. And I like my research topic to focus on how theatre or using theatre techniques can improve our language learning, right? So, for me personally, I don't know yet. I could go into teaching, you know, I could be your future French or Indonesian teacher, or drama teacher maybe. So I could be a teacher, or I could be an actor and win an Oscar, right? And not just, you know, be in movies where I play characters who speak English, but also be versatile enough to play characters who speak, you know, French, Italian, Chinese, etc. Right.
Cool. Three. Thank you, Colin. You are about to finish your university degree and graduate. What are your future career plans, and how do you think your language skills will be beneficial in your chosen career path?
So as I've mentioned, right after graduation, I'll be heading off to Japan in Oita Prefecture to work as a coordinator for international relations with the Japanese government. Some of my roles will include translation, interpretation, promoting Australian culture to Japan, and then promoting the Oita Prefecture to the world. They've updated me recently on the upcoming projects I've been working on. They include a Rugby World Cup in 2019, as well as the National Cultural Festival that will be coming to Oita later on this year, so I'm very excited for them. As Japan is still quite a monolingual society, I think having a good command of Japanese language would definitely benefit someone who wants to work, especially in the cultural promotions department, which is something that I want to focus on when I return to Australia in the future. The other thing, the very last thing, is like, other than picking up the language skills here at UWA, one of the things I've gained is like public speaking skills. Like, I know it's really daunting to speak in front of like other people and express your ideas, but trust me, if you speak to like a whole room of people over and over again, it gets better eventually. So definitely be proactive when you graduate from high school, and you improve and find opportunities over and over.
Thank you, Steve. Feel free to do so, just put your hand up. If I can't see, wave it around. Does anyone want to ask a question first up?
It's definitely easier if you continue through high school, if you have the option. I just didn't have the option. In a kind of cruel twist of fate, the school hired a new Japanese teacher in year 11, but because I missed year 10, I wasn't able to go in. So I never had that chance. Definitely maintain, if you're thinking you might want to do a language, even if you don't, it's just really useful. So keep it going through high school so that when you do jump in to university level studies, you've already got your brain switched on. It's all there though. Like if I went to study Japanese tomorrow, it would all kind of come back. When I go back to Italy, it all comes back really quickly. But if you ask me to speak Italian right now, it'd be really rusty. But give me a couple of days in Sicily and I'll be chatting away. It really is all there. The more you keep it current, the better. I think everyone would probably agree with that. Yeah.
Yep. Any other questions? Yes? Yep.
What languages do you guys find the hardest to learn?
English.
So I think, you know, for monolingual English speakers out there, please don't complain when you're in your language class. Oh my god, this language is so hard. Like, Sinlan and I, we had to learn, other people as well here, we had to learn English, right? We took that effort. So you guys can do it as well. You guys can learn our languages as well. But for me, it's French.
Yeah.
Colin, do you ever like mix
That's a good question. Actually, yes, I do, because at home, I code switch a lot. So I speak, you know, English, Indonesian, Japanese, a bit of Mandarin mix, right? So I had this problem of mixing, because I started Spanish before Italian, right? So at that time, my Spanish level was higher than my Italian. So my brain was conditioned to think in Spanish when I was doing Italian here at UWA. And yes, at the start I would mix some words around, but you know, that's fun. I don't see it as something negative. It's more like, it's cool, you know? And the point is the communication. If you can communicate with someone, even though you make any mistakes, little tiny mistakes, you can get your idea across, that's perfect.
Yeah. Awesome, one more question. We've got time for one more, yes?
My room for hours speaking another language, just practicing, or like before an oral exam, I would be practicing that aloud the whole day. And I found that like that really helped me memorize things. And when I got to uni, I could still recall things that I'd done in my year 12 exams. Like 2 years into uni, I was still using phrases from my year 12 voice exams because they were just ingrained in my memory. So oral exams, definitely practice. Don't be shy because there's nothing to be shy about. The more you talk out loud, the more confidence you gain.
For me, it's friendship. As Ross mentioned before, when you learn another person's language, you learn about their culture, you can enter their world as well. And I have had the privilege of having good friends who are native speakers of my target language. So I've got friends who speak Italian, French, Spanish, or the target language that I want to learn. And when I tell them like sincerely that, you know, I'm not very good at it, I'm still learning, but I want to improve, they're more than happy to help, right? And when you show that enthusiasm to someone, just put yourself in their shoes. Like, if someone's trying to learn your language, you wouldn't judge them, right? You would more likely to help them. So my strategy is friendship. Having native speaker friends have been very helpful for me.
Yeah, definitely true, that one. And the best way to learn how to speak it like a native is to hear a native speaker say it. For me, with study, you've just got to love the grind. The harder you work, the better your results are going to be. So just give it everything. Look, even if at this stage you're kind of going, oh, study, whatever, make it matter to yourself. Get motivated, get around it. In terms of practical things, keeping a diary, like I said, is a really good one. Really easy to do before you go to sleep, even if you only write a few lines. Another one for oral exams, I recorded every past exam question on my iPod so I could then play it back to myself and then answer it. So there was hundreds of them on there. And I did them again and again and again, and it got me 95% in the final oral exam. So it must have done something. And then beyond that, just work that vocabulary and just keep trying. That's all there is to it.
As Holden was saying, I agree that it's important to practice with your friend who speak at the, you know, around your level. But more importantly, please find some fluent speakers. They don't have to be native, but like fluent, so they can fine tune your, especially oral skills. You need correction. And if you do manage to get into university, always approach your mentors, be they lecturers or tutors, if you need their help. My experience here is like they have been nothing but helpful. Do approach them, you can learn so much more.
My thing would be, think about the areas of language that there are that you will have to learn. So there's four things you need to learn. You have to learn how to speak, read, listen, and speak. Speak, listen, read, and write, right? So there's two written and two spoken. So you need to learn how to do all four of those things. And every exam will test you on all four of those things. So you have your written exam and your oral exam. So you need to identify which one of those is your weakest points and focus on those. So for me, I can speak I can read and write. My comprehension is really crap. It's okay, so I'm better at talk, but I've realised that's my weak point. So when I study, I try to focus on doing things like listening to like French speaking, or watching a documentary, or watching TV shows in French, so I can practice that. So find out your weak point of those four, focus on getting it right, and then do it over and over and over, like rote learning. And I know rote learning is not very popular or fun, but I would just sit there and like give myself vocab tests, or write verb conjugations like 8 times, like the whole thing, 8 times, just so I got it in my head. It's not fun, but if your tip is how to do it well, you have to put in time to do that.
Great, thanks for coming.
Still about lecturers. From my competition entry, I spoke on a national level about food. At first, I thought it was really stupid, but my lecturer was really supportive. She's like, yeah, I'll help you improve, I'll fix everything that you need. So do approach the experts who have been very sweet to us all over university. I think that's what she is.
The only thing I would add is make mistakes. Make a lot of mistakes, and don't be ashamed of making mistakes. So a lot of the time what holds me back learning is I don't want to look stupid in front of other people. But in fact, when you learn a language, you have to be willing to look stupid in front of everyone repeatedly. So the other day I was speaking to someone in French for 10 minutes at an event, different event than I was talking about. And right at the end, I went to say, have a good evening, and I went, bon année, which is Happy New Year. So she looked at me like I was an idiot. I corrected myself and went on. But I'm so used to doing that and stuffing up that that didn't really faze me so much. Like, you just get used to good looks on that mistake for a while. So get used to making mistakes and be comfortable making mistakes. You have to.
Can I just make one more? Just really quickly, Eros. Like we said, look around the room. We live in a multicultural society. It's a multicultural world. Learning a language is the best way that you can understand and appreciate another culture, another language, different people, different food, and we really need to get on board with it because, like I said, look around the room, we're all so different. One more point, don't let people undermine languages, because the amount of people I've had say to me, Shaima, you're doing engineering, what the hell has Italian got to do with that? Why are you even wasting time with this? I've had people question why I'm studying this language for the past 8 years, 9 years, and my response to them is, it's none of your business, firstly, and secondly, I'm not learning this language so I can use it. I don't know if I will use it. Hopefully I will be an engineer in Italy, but if I don't get there, it's the skills that I've acquired along the way. It's the soft skills, the communication, these things that we've been talking about, cultural appreciation. It's these things that really shape you into who you are, and those are the skills that people look out for and people really appreciate. So don't let people undermine you taking a language and just make fun of it, because it's nothing to be made fun of. It's really not. You'll be making fun of them a few years down the line. You will be making fun of them. That's what I've got to say.
Thank you.